State Historical Society of Iowa, you will discover tremendous resources for researching disability issues and experiences in Iowa. Collections include oral histories and memoirs in the Iowa Polio Stories Project, or detailed annual reports from the various institutions around Iowa, such as the Glenwood School. And as an example, we have a children's magazine called The Goldfinch, which features Iowans with disabilities, an article in there. And then another one is about from the our Iowa Heritage Illustrated magazine. And the article is called No Middle Ground, Change and Controversy at Glenwood State School. And another example to show you guys is I made a resources for disability studies at the State Historical Society. It's a bibliography of what you can find at our institution if you would like to visit us. And now I'd like to introduce our speaker today. A Des Moines native, Andrew Tubbs, is a master's candidate in musicology at the University of Iowa. He holds a BA in music with minors in German and business from Wartburg College. His research interests include 19th century German song cycles, Reformation studies, and the intersection between disability studies and music, specifically the musical representation of the disabled body on stage and screen. He has presented his research at numerous national and international conferences on film, musicals, and disability. Today's talk, Sounding the Feeble Mind, Eugenic Depictions of Feeblemindedness on Screen and in Music, will feature Andrew's work on how music is an important voice in presenting these stereotypes of disability to an audience. Please join me in welcoming Andrew Tubbs.
I'm just going to keep talking until I know that the mic is on.
Hear me now, right? Mic is now on. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for coming. Thank you, Hang. It's always great seeing you. I'm just going to get started. In Richard Rogers' autobiography, the composer theorized that a musical worked perfectly when there was, quote, nothing extraneous or foreign. It was a work created by many that gave the impression of having been created by one, end quote. While scholars have repeatedly hailed Oklahoma as the cornerstone of the integrated musical, the narrative of Oklahoma relied on an extraneous or foreign other, Judd Fry. Many different scholars have noted how ethnic, racial, and cultural signifiers have been assigned to Judd to rationalize his villainous characterization. From Judd's original incarnation as Jeter Fry in Ling Riggs' original play in 1931, Green Grow the Lilacs, to Fred Zinnemann's 1955 film adaptation, Judd's childlike intelligence, sexual perversion, physical appearance, and criminal disposition have been interpreted as exemplifying Jewish, indigenous, and African-American stereotypes. While issues of race and ethnicity are central in understanding Judd's alienation and ultimate death, I contend that Judd's narrative and musical role stems from a larger social force present in the cultural ether at the time of Oklahoma, the American eugenics movement, and its apprehension over the degenerate capabilities of the feeble mind. By introducing feeble-mindedness as a lens to understand Judd alongside scholars' previous readings, this talk suggests that we can interpret Judd's musical otherness in a new way. In Stephen Rogers' analysis of mental disabilities in music, he contends that the distortion of standard musical conventions can parallel mental deformations by mimicking the psychological symptoms of the disability. Likewise, the degeneration of Judd's musical material in songs such as Lonely Room and Poor Judd is Dead assumes the guise of both physical symptoms and social stereotypes of feeble-mindedness, specifically the idea of obsession. To support the musical's narrative, by employing Megan Traeger's musical application of Martin Norden's concept of the obsessive avenger, this talk will use disability studies and its insight into the eugenics movement to analyze the 1955 film adaptation of the famous Dream Ballet sequence. Ultimately, Judd's othering musical and textual characterizations, grounded in the lingering eugenic sensibilities of the mid-20th century, betray an inherent disabled threat to the narrative's newly unified community. Therefore, for the musical to return to its normative state, Judd's disability and his musical deformations must be eradicated. And here's where I ask, does anybody need a refresher on the plot of Oklahoma? I don't want to assume anything, making sure that I'm not leaving anybody in the guest, but I am prepared to move on if not. So I want to ask, how exactly can we think of the character of Judd in terms of disability? I doubt many of you have thought of Judd as a disabled person before this talk. I believe this is because our definition of disability has radically changed since 1943, and we no longer perceive Judd as disabled. Despite our hesitation to label Judd as disabled, many individuals have used language associated with disability to describe him. For example, scholar Bruce Curley questions Judd's mental capacity by assuming he is quote-unquote dim-witted because of his short, ungrammatical phrases and grunts. Tim Carter justifies Judd's exclusion because of his quote-unquote sociopathic tendencies and sociopathic isolation. Lastly, scholar Ray McNack characterizes Judd as a quote-unquote psychotic loner. While we do not immediately jump to characterize Judd as disabled, the continuous reference to his mental incapacity or instability suggests disability colors how we perceive the character even today. I suggest that this is because Judd used to be seen as a disabled character by audiences of the early 20th century, and this characterization still echoes even until today. To understand how we can interpret Judd as disabled, we must ask ourselves what the definition of disability was in the early 20th century. Specifically, we must ask what the definition of disability was during the American eugenics movement. Driven by the rise of statistics and genealogy, the American eugenics movement was a pseudoscientific movement of the early to mid 20th century to improve the human species by eliminating biological defects through breeding strategies derived from animal husbandry. While eugenicists attempted to remove all forms of defects, they primarily targeted mental disabilities such as feeble-mindedness due to its assumed correlation with immoral activities like alcoholism, crime, and prostitution. Eugenicists aimed to police who could procreate and pass along their genetic material by segregating, sterilizing, or in extreme examples, euthanizing those determined to be mentally defective. Although eugenicists failed to produce a singular diagnostic definition of feeble-mindedness, the term consistently denoted an individual's inability to develop past the mental age of 12 years old. Yet, one's mental capacity was not the only reason why eugenicists labeled an individual as feeble-minded. Eugenicists believed humans existed on a hierarchy of evolution where certain individuals, mainly Anglo-American men, were more evolutionary advanced than others. Below average intelligence marked the feeble-minded as inherently less developed. Thus, if the feeble-minded were permitted to reproduce, eugenicists feared that the human race would degenerate. The distinctions, however, between perceived subnormal intelligence and other forms of what eugenicists determined to be quote-unquote lower origin humans were often blurred. For example, eugenicists often portrayed African Americans, indigenous people, and criminals as feeble-minded because of their position in a eugenic hierarchy. Hence, for eugenicists, race, ethnicity, and immoral behavior represented an evolutionary disability that often exposed itself through feeble-mindedness. Inspired by the social application of evolution in Charles Darwin's Descent of Man and Francis Galton's Hereditary Genius, eugenicists argued that the human race was in fact a species that maintained evolutionary origins similar to the rest of the animal kingdom. Therefore, if humans could improve animal or plant species through selective breeding, humans themselves could control their own development. I have to give a little forewarning. I'm quoting very old and very racist men. I apologize for that. John Kellogg, a prominent American eugenicist, lamented, quote, "Man has improved every useful creature and every useful plant with which he has come in contact, with the exception of his own species," end quote. The path towards advancing the human race for Darwin was clear, quote, "Hardly anyone is so ignorant as to allow his worst animals to breed," end quote. Yet civilized people permit their weak members of their societies to propagate their kind. To reverse this trend, Galton reasoned that humans must, quote, "give to the more suitable races or strains of blood a better chance of prevailing speedily over the less suitable than they otherwise would have," end quote. Eugenicists, primarily white men of Anglo-American heritage, were quick to claim the Anglo-American stock as evolutionary superior to the quote-unquote savage or primitive races, such as those of African descent, indigenous populations, and Eastern Europeans. To differentiate oneself from the lower origins, eugenicists asserted that these racialized groups shared more genetic similarities to animals than humans based on their perceived disabilities like feeble-mindedness. For example, a 1903 article in the Chicago Daily Tribune stated, quote, The black men's sins of immorality, which shock so many people, are the sins of the untutored animal. He has as many domestic ties as the noblest horse or the most faithful dog." End quote. The article concluded this animalistic disposition was directly linked to a deficiency of intelligence. This assumed association between evolution, race, and intellect solidified the racialized other's status as inherently disabled. Thus, noted eugenicist Henry Goddard could predict that 40% to 50% of all immigrants entering the United States were feeble-minded. In addition to the eugenic conflation of race and disability, eugenicists employed feeble-mindedness to regulate non-normative behaviors that violated a bourgeois sensibility. While social commentators had long attributed depraved behaviors such as crime, alcoholism, and vagrancy, and sexual immorality to mental disabilities, the eugenics movement blamed disability as the causal factor. In his book, The Kallikak Family, A Study of the Hereditary of Feeble-Minded, Feeble-mindedness. Goddard argued that society could eliminate social crimes by controlling the spread of feeble-mindedness. By tracing feeble-mindedness in his pedigree study of the Kallikak family, Goddard concluded that a feeble-minded parent was destined to breed feeble-minded children. These children were bound to become prostitutes, criminals, and drunkards. Conversely, non-disabled parents continued to produce law-abiding children. Because of pedigree studies such as Goddard's, eugenicists could diagnose somebody as feeble-minded if they merely violated normative standards of society. What frightened eugenicists most about the feeble-mind, however, was not simply its connection to the racialized other or seemingly social behavior. Instead, the menace of the feeble mind was its degenerative capability in a hierarchical evolutionary model. Established in the 19th century, the theory of degeneration taught that humans could deteriorate to a lower, less advanced form of life. Popularized by French psychiatrist Benedict Moral, degeneration occurred primarily due to sinful living, such as participating in immoral sexual practices or enjoying drugs and alcohol. The degenerate lifestyle resulted in what Moral called schemata of degeneration, which he characterized as physical and mental disabilities that marked an individual as innately debased. By the turn of the century, eugenicists perceived degeneration theory as the proof for their evolutionary social schema. If human beings progressed through primitive ancestral stages, then the degenerate was the activist return to these baser levels of humanity. Akin to moral schemata of degeneration, eugenicists relied upon perceived mental disabilities, mainly one's mental age, to denote a degenerative individual. However, unlike earlier models of degenerative theory that maintained a clear distinction between one's morals and intelligence, eugenicists described the feeble mind as intrinsically depraved. Eugenicists blamed quote-unquote primitive instincts as the cause for one's moral decline into criminality and sexual promiscuity. These primitive instincts were innate in every human, but they were strongest during a child's early adolescence, go figure, primarily ages 9 through 12. Since the feeble-minded's mental abilities assumedly cease to develop past this age, they are more susceptible to these unsightly behaviors. Describing this phenomenon, Goddard states, quote, "Now, if a child's mental ability is arrested in his development at just about that time, then he is a liar, a thief, a sex pervert, or whatever else he might be, because those instincts are strong in him," end quote. If one could progress beyond the mental age of 12, however, an individual possessed the mental capability to control these instincts and achieve a proper moral standing. Thus, eugenicists linked degenerate behavior directly to mental disability. Branded by this diminished intelligence, the feeble mind controlled the power to degenerate the strong Anglo-American genetic stock by returning to the bestial behaviors of more quote-unquote primitive races. Identical to the eugenic rhetoric used to denigrate the racial other, the actions of the feeble-minded were continuously seen through animalistic metaphors. When recounting... When recounting the criminality of the feeble-minded, the founder of the Eugenics Record Office, Charles Davenport, stated that their behaviors, quote, are crimes for a 20th century citizen, but they are normal acts of our remote ape-like ancestors, end quote. Davenport continued by emphasizing the need to curtail these brutish impulses. Quote, if we are to build up in America a society worthy of the species man, then we must take such steps as will prevent the increase of even perpetuation of animalistic strains, end quote. Thus, in order to protect the American genetic stock, the American journalist Henry Louis Mencken suggested that sterilization was, quote, the only remedy to strike at the source of all incompetence, whether social or economic, mental or physical. Let a resolute attack be made upon the fecundity of all the males on the lowest rung of the social ladder. Understanding the historical background of the American eugenics movement and its construction of feeble-mindedness unearths how Judd embodies eugenicist fears towards disability. Many of Judd's defining character traits, like his continuous association with animals, his diminished intelligence, and criminal and sexual perversions, resembled the eugenic formation of degeneracy and feeble-mindedness. Indeed, peer-reviewed reviews of both the Broadway version and the 1955 film adaptation confirm this assumption by referring to Judd as a degenerate. While this does not mean Judd was expressly written to be a disabled character, I believe both Ling Riggs and Oscar Hammerstein employed cultural signifiers of otherness present during the eugenics movement to instantaneously denote Judd as a degenerate, villainous character. The first notable marker of Jeter Fry's and later Judd's feeble-minded degeneracy is his relationship with what eugenicists perceived as quote-unquote primitive races, particularly an indigenous population. Even before Jeter enters the stage in Green Grow the Lilacs, Ling Riggs clued the audience into Judd's racial origins and the complications this might pose to the narrative. When characterizing Jeter, Curley declares that he is a, quote, bullet-colored, growly man with bushy eyebrows, end quote. This phrase, along with other references to Jeter's simian features, such as his hair-covered hands, had led to various interpretations of Jeter's racial background. For example, Tim Carter explains the dialogue projects an ambiguous racial makeup that could be a reference to African descent, whereas Bryce Curley suggests that Ling Riggs' Oklahoma childhood and his Cherokee heritage likely positions Jeter as an indigenous character. In addition to racial signifiers, Riggs employed animalistic metaphors to suggest Jeter's lower origins and thus justify his depraved actions. Even before Riggs revealed Jeter's criminalistic and sexual characteristics to the audience, the dialogue between Curley and Aunt Eller paint Jeter as bestial. After Jeter exits from Aunt Eller's living room with only a quote-unquote surly grunt, Aunt Eller says he lives out in the smokehouse, which used to be the doghouse. To which Curley chuckingly retorts, that's the place for him. Instead of living in a structure suitable for humans, Jeter wallows in the filth like a dog. In addition to the animalistic symbolism, eugenicists viewed a primitive living environment to be proof of one's degeneracy. Jeter's brutish hovel, thus, is a central theme in communicating his vile disposition. When Curley confronts Jeter in the smokehouse about Lori, Curley threatens that, quote, somebody ought to tell her what you are, end quote. Instead of living outdoors like a real man, Jeter is a rattlesnake, quote, setting in here, in this filthy hole, setting up, a crawling, and a festering, end quote. In adapting Jeter Fry in the musical, Hammerstein continued to link Judd with primitive beasts to degrade the character. When compiling the book for the musical, Hammerstein retained a majority of Riggs's original dialogue, especially when it came to the descriptions of Judd. In addition to the many references to Judd's animal nature in the script, Hammerstein maintained animality as a key theme in his lyrics in the songs Poor Judd is Dead and Lonely Room. For example, when Curley imagines Judd's funeral in the song Poor Judd is Dead, he intones, quote, he loved the mice and vermin in the barn, and he treats the rats like equals, which was right, end quote. Judd is not simply like an animal, he is an animal. Besides the repeated indications of Jeter's and Judd's animalistic mannerism, Judd's feeble-mindedness and its generative capabilities are alluded to through his lack of intelligence. Admittedly, the general community is not well educated, but there are instances where Judd is specifically singled out for his inferior intellect. For example, Curley observes that like depictions of indigenous peoples in film, Judd speaks using two or three words, ungrammatical phrases and grunts. These short, imprecise phrases are present in both the dialogue and the lyrics. Unlike the poetic lyrics in songs like The Surrey with the Fringe on Top, or Many a New Day. Jug's lyrics are abrupt and fragmentary. So here are the lyrics for Surrey with the Fringe on Top. You can see that nice flowing lines with lots of rhyme, long phrases. While the previous song enjoys expansive lyrics, Lonely Room is marked by undeveloped lyrics like the floor creaks, the door squeaks, short, choppy phrases. Additionally, Judd is too dim-witted to recognize that Curly is mocking him during the song Poor Judd is Dead. Instead of being insulted by the numerous disparaging comments, Judd is enthralled by imagining his own death. A stage note in the script even remarks that, quote, Judd is too emotionally exalted by the spirit of Curly's singing to be analytical, end quote. According to Hammerstein, Judd became at this moment, quote unquote, not just wicked, but a comic figure. Indeed, the New York Times echoed this assessment of Judd's misperception, calling the number, quote unquote, amazingly comic. By amplifying Judd's inability to be analytical and falling prey to Curly's jest, Judd fulfills the trope of the comic idiot. His childlike intelligence is something that the musical can openly mock to segregate Judd from his non-disabled peers. Judd's violence and sexual terror, specifically towards Laurie and the community, represents a pathological abnormality that needs to be controlled. Essentially, the musical rationalizes that Judd's innate degeneracy prompts him to commit horrific acts. This ideology directly echoes how eugenicists such as Godard argued feeble-mindedness perpetuated sinful mannerisms because of an individual's undeveloped mental abilities. When relating to Aunt Eller, how Jug lurks outside her window at night, Laurie insists that, quote, something is wrong inside him, end quote. There is an unknown biological force that threatens her. This something is even too powerful for Judd himself to control. After she fires Jug for his behavior, Judd insists that what happens next is unstoppable. Quote, brought it on yourself. Can't help it. Can't never rest. Told you the way it was. You wouldn't listen, end quote. Judd's overt promise of revenge suggests there is an inner drive that requires him to respond, some sort of animal instinct that his feeble brain cannot govern. By setting the character of Judd Fry against the backdrop of the American eugenics movement and its construction of feeble-mindedness, this talk suggests that disability studies can provide new inroads to realize how Judd's musical material reinforces his othered position. Drawing upon the work of Martin Norton's concept of the obsessive avenger, this musical analysis will show how the 1955 film adaptation of the famous Dream Ballet sequence appropriated physical symptoms as well as social stereotypes of feeble-mindedness to paint Judd as degenerate. Opposed to the songs that characterize Laurie's and Curly's love, such as The Surrey with the Fringe on Top or People Will Say We're in Love, Judd's musical underscoring is best described as obsessive. These musical obsessions, much like a degenerative's primitive instincts, do not follow a logical musical trajectory and endangers the musical motives the couple holds so dear. Although obsession was not a diagnostic criterion for feeble-mindedness, psychologists and social workers understood that the intellectual degeneracy of the feeble mind directly led to a more severe social problem, insanity. Fearful of the reported 468% increase of insane patients in asylums, social commentators frantically searched for the symptoms and causes of this alarming increase. Reported by the New York Times in 1923, insanity resulted from an intense obsession that overwhelmed one's moral senses to the extent that one may even steal, kill, or violate moral principles to fulfill this drive. The article continued by emphatically stating the growth of subnormal intelligence was to blame for this rise in insanity. Simply, the degenerative capabilities of the feeble mind pushed the human race to experience more debilitating physical and social symptoms by allowing these manic oppressions to go unchecked. Musical obsession emerged in the music of Oklahoma in two primary ways, a melodic obsession or motivic obsession. To begin with, melodic obsession is when the melody or musical accompaniment becomes fixed on one note or pattern. The music seems to get stuck. It is rare for the music of Oklahoma to feel as if it gets stuck. The musical normalcy seems to be songs that have sweeping melodies that resemble the naturalness of Oklahoma's landscape. For example, the titular song, Oklahoma, oh, Oklahoma, where the wind comes around, da-da-da-da, has a rousing melody that never becomes fixated on a singular musical gesture. This normalcy, however, is broken whenever Judd Fry sings. Compared to the rest of the musical numbers, Lonely Room is the musical's other. Apart from Laurie's final verse in Out of My Dreams, Lonely Room is the show's only solo. Further, unlike the rest of Rogers' songs, Lonely Room does not maintain a clear social function. It is not a social dance meant to reconcile the differences between farmer and cowhand, nor does the song suggest the possibility of an acceptable marriage. Instead, the song centers on how Judd is going to take Laurie for his own. Musically, Lonely Room is marked by the overt use of dissonance and minor tonality, so very harsh sounds and very kind of sad sounds, a treatment which heretofore has never been heard in Oklahoma. This effect is primarily achieved with melodic, what I call melodic obsession, and it ultimately mirrors the expectations of physical symptoms of feeble-mindedness. The song begins with the strings pulsating on a dissonant chord, creating an eerie soundscape. Before Judd can speak, the music is already stuck in a rut. It cannot get past its fixation to achieve the happier melodies of other Oklahoma songs. As can be expected, Judd picks up this musical obsession with his sung melody. The melody either incessantly repeats a falling motive, such as on the line "The Floor Creaks," or Judd continuously repeats the same note over and over again. Let's listen to Lonely Room.
There's a field mouse a nibbling on a broom, and I sit by myself like a cobweb on a shelf, by myself in a lonely room.
Unlike the rest of the musical, Judd is unable to produce music that satisfies our expectations of how good music should sound. We believe that an aesthetically pleasing, logical musical trajectory is one such as an "Oh, What a Beautiful Morning." Instead, Judd's lack of intelligence forces him to ruminate mentally and musically on his one and only desire. Thus, these musically fixed notes mimic the physical symptoms of feeblemindedness. The second type of obsession that I'm talking about today is motivic obsession. Motivic obsession is when a musical motive or repeated musical theme stops or disrupts the expected musical trajectory. This musical device largely emerges to announce that something has gone terribly wrong. The music will abruptly shift from a musical melody that we previously associated with happy thoughts to a theme that we know signals danger. This type of musical narrative resembles a familiar narrative trope that is called the obsessive avenger. In Martin Norton's encyclopedic documentation of the use of physical disability in the American film industry, Norton observes a general anxiety surrounding the disabled body that he calls the obsessive avenger. The obsessive avenger is a narrative device that depicts people with disabilities as continuously seeking revenge on society for forcing them to assume a lowly station in life. At any moment, the disabled person could enact immense amount of physical and psychological pain upon the community. This obsessive danger could become so overwhelming that the disabled person would gain control of the community, forcing the normative characters to bend to their will. The disabled character often achieved this goal by either violently or sexually controlling a vulnerable female character, in this case, Laurie. For the community to neutralize the danger, the disability either needed to be cured or destroyed. Applying the obsessive avenger trope to film music, Megan Traeger argues that this stereotype was fundamental to the continuation of eugenic conceptions of disabilities, particularly in the scoring practices of 1950s horror films. The musical scores for these horror films mimicked the obsessive avenger narrative by creating two categories of musical motives, which she identified as a love and monster motive. While the love motive was frequently beautiful and song-like, the monster motive possessed some form of abnormality, such as dissonance or repetition. As the disabled character asserted themselves among the community, the monster motive overtakes the love motive and completely dominates the film's sonic world. Only when the cinematic environment removes the disability by either killing or curing the disabled figure does the musical score kill off the monster theme so that the love theme can return to its normal state. The Oklahoma Dream Ballet musically pits Judd against Laurie's true love for Curly through the relationship between his monster modus, derived from the song Poor Judd is Dead and Lonely Room, and Laurie's love theme, The Surrey with the Fringe on Top. I'm going to play these briefly, so when we watch the films, you'll be able to hear these motifs and identify this. So this is Surrey with the Fringe on Top. And then this is the second of Judd's two monster motifs, Poor Judd is Dead. The fear that Judd's disabled musical material can rise up and rear its ugly head to take over the lovely sound of music that has once been heard adheres to the social stereotypes surrounding the feeble-minded individual, fearing that they could enact some sort of pain upon women and take over society. Before Judd enters the Dream Ballet, Laurie and Curly, along with their musical material, enjoy complete control over their dreamlike universe. When Judd magically takes the place of Curly, however, the music introduces a disabling problem that blocks the ballet from progressing as expected. In addition to Judd's musical hindrance to the dream wedding, Judd orally claims Laurie for himself by forcing her musical themes to reside in a dissonant and unfamiliar state. Faced with the decision between taking Curly or Judd to the box social, Laurie purchases the elixir of Egypt from the traveling peddler, Ali Hakim. The elixir is said to clear the user's mind to assist with complex decisions. On the one hand, she wants to go with Curly, but she fears Judd will try and seek revenge by killing her beloved. After inhaling the elixir's fumes, her decision and its consequences are played out through the Dream Ballet with Agnes DeMille's choreography performed by the Dream characters Babby Linton, James Mitchell, and Rog Steiger. The ballet leads the audience through a fantastical depiction of Laurie's and Curly's wedding with the introduction of the love theme derived from the song The Surrey with the Fringe on Top. However, the love theme will soon be threatened as Judd distorts Laurie's dream into a grotesque nightmare. After her wedding veil falls from the heaven, plausibly seen as God's blessing on the union, the ballet shifts from Oh What a Beautiful Morning, the melody of Oh What a Beautiful Morning, to the Surrey with the Fringe on Top love motif. The transition is synchronized with Curly, clad in his Sunday best, arriving with the rest of the wedding party in tow. The musical moment is meaningful for the young couple. Laurie's phantasmic remembrance of the Surrey with the Fringe on Top harkens back to the beginning of the musical and the couple's first love duet. The love theme continues as Laurie marches down the aisle. However, instead of the happy music of dreams past, the ballet starts to insert moments of musical dissonance. Something is not right. Indeed, the musical tension begins to rise as we witness someone lifting Laurie's veil. Although we assume it is Curly, we learn, much to our horror, that Judd has taken his place. Rogers scored this moment with a dissonant stinger chord which shocks the audience and Laurie's love motif. The love motif frantically searches for its proper conclusion, but Judd's disabling musical presence makes it impossible. The love theme just cannot overcome Judd's obsessive musical material that one can hear pulsating in the lower strings. In turn, Laurie's music becomes disabled itself, as it is forced to repeat the same melodic gesture over and over again. remaining 10 minutes of the ballet visually and aurally emphasize Judd's degenerate life and its threat to a normative social and musical order. In Laurie's attempt to evade Judd, she escapes into a Gothic-style church. It turns out, however, that this is just a delusion, and she has entered a surrealist rendering of a saloon inside Judd's smokehouse, complete with Judd's postcard dancing girls. Laurie's entrance is accompanied by an out-of-tune player piano riffing over the poor Judd is dead monster motif. This moment is the oral personification of the obsessive Avenger trope. The disabled musical material has usurped the previous musical normalcy and placed the female protagonist in jeopardy. The monster theme sounds as one of Judd's dancing girls, a symbol of Judd's degenerate lifestyle, drags Laurie into his clutches. Although Judd's presence and themes terrorize Laurie's marriage and the cohesive community identity of Oklahoma, the central thesis of an obsessive avenger, enacting physical harm on the community and possessing the female character, has yet to be musically realized. That is until the arrival of Judd's most sinister monster motif, Lonely Room, a theme that Ling Riggs reportedly said would, quote, scare the hell out of the audience, end quote. In an attempt to rescue Laurie, Curly squares off face-to-face with the much larger Judd Fry. As the two men come to blows, the monster motif enters the ballet with its dissonant scoring, brash trumpet sound, and obsessive musical repetition. Judd's size overwhelms the smaller man. Judd repeatedly punches his romantic rival until he lays lifeless at his feet. Stepping over Curly's dead body, Judd grasps Laurie and throws her over his head. He carries her away to the tune of a distorted version of the love theme, the Surrey with the Fringe on Top. The first part, For the story to end happily, the disabled problem must be dealt with both in the narrative and the music. According to the obsessive Avenger trope, the story reaches its satisfying conclusion when the disabled character has either been killed or cured. Likewise, the disabled musical material must be discarded so the musical can return to its normative state. Disability studies scholar Rosemary Garland Thompson, who will be here next week, coins this narrative drive as the cultural logic of euthanasia. Much like the eugenic rhetoric of the 20th century, the disabled figure in Oklahoma must be cast aside for the betterment of society. During Laurie's and Curly's wedding celebration, an inebriated Judd sets the couple's farm ablaze and attacks the newlywed with a knife. During Judd's attack, the orchestra is replaying Judd's monster motif, Poor Judd is Dead. In an attempt to protect Laurie, Curly lunges at Judd, who accidentally falls on his own knife. The orchestra meekly coughs out Judd's last musical gasp of his theme and tell him and his music is dead. The feeble-minded threat no longer poses a danger to the community. Indeed, the society is well rid of Judd Fry, so much that they pronounce together, without a proper trial, Curly is not guilty. In fact, the community heralds him as a hero with a rousing rendition of Oh, What a Beautiful Morning in Oklahoma. Thus, Oklahoma completes the obsessive Avenger narrative and musical trope with the community's reinstated sense of musical normalcy. Rodgers and Hammerstein's Oklahoma is widely considered as a defining moment in the history of the American musical. Its success, however, must be viewed in the purview of the social conditions surrounding the source play, the musical, and the film adaptation. The show's narratives and its musical story arc drew upon stereotypical depictions of otherness born from the height of the American eugenics movement. constantly bombarded with newspaper reports of the depravity of the feeble-minded, Americans in the early 20th century were inundated with reasons to be fearful of otherness. Eugenic dogma seeped into the rhetoric of everyday life, even so far as to affect the consumption of musical narratives. Judd's musical material cannot become part of a cohesive musical community due to its potential to corrupt the musical traits deemed to be civilized. Much like the defective, degenerate, feeble-minded individuals that carried the potential to taint the American Anglo genetic stock, Judd's musical material must be isolated and destroyed to preserve the purity of Oklahoma's musical world. Thank you.
Produced in advance of the musical?
The original play was produced in 1931 to lackluster reviews. It wasn't, it was well received to some extent, but not too much. But then there was a lot of American themed operas that were coming about at this time, specifically Porgy and Bess, and that really gave the impetus for Oklahoma to be such a success almost a little bit more than a decade later.
A fascinating talk, and I really appreciate you delivering it today. I've got a whole new perspective on one of my favorite musicals.
Does somebody else have a question?
Have you ever heard of epigenetics?
Epigenetics, please inform me.
Well, we've always had the idea that it's nature versus nurture, but epigenetics doesn't change the genes. Mm-hmm. It causes various patterns of genes to be increase their expression,
correct,
or to decrease their expression. And I'm just wondering, with your interest and knowledge of music, what do you think the impact on human development music has in terms of this epigenetic phenomena?
Yeah.
We know that things like stress can be very detrimental to your development, and that the effects of that can be passed on to your offspring.
Yeah, I'm thinking specifically of how eugenicists thought of jazz music. I want to thank you for your question. They thought that jazz music could actually disable children that were still in the womb. So there was a protest in Cincinnati in the 30s because there was going to be a movie theater built next to a hospital for single women. And they believed that the jazz music could impact the unborn child, right? So there were a lot of ideas of this more quote-unquote primitive music that didn't have the right vibrations. We're not too far away from railroad spine, right? We still are thinking a lot of how vibrations affect the human body, right? So this unnatural jazz vibration could have a very detrimental impact to not only the physical health of an individual, but also the moral health. So thank you for your question.
Andrew, I'm going to be going to New York City in a couple weeks. And
are you
I understand
see the, are
well,
you...
that's what I'm getting at. I may see the new production. I'm wondering, is there any comparison that I should know about?
Unfortunately, the only thing that I know about this new production is what I've read through reviews, which doesn't provide a lot of information. I was lucky enough to sit in on a rehearsal of the production last week, but it was only singing. It wasn't any of staging that was happening, but you are if you attend, it's going to be amazing. I've been told that it still is very much, even though we are so far removed from this time period, that we are still thinking of Judd, or at least this production thinks of Judd, as someone that is essentially criminal by birth, essentially because of this genetic influence that is happening. So even though we're still largely removed from this time period, these types of stereotypes are still clinging on in some ideas of this musical. Thank you for that question. Hopefully you get to see it. It should be awesome.
Well, thank you so much for all of you coming, and thank you for your wonderful program.
Thank you guys so much.